Before 1992, before I ever touched a computer, I played a lot of games on the NES. And on the NES, one of the most fascinating things to me were the password generators. I am Bisqwit, and in this series we explore how old games generate their passwords. Today we will deal with Castlevania 2, Simon's Quest. For starters, we will take a look at the password screen. The passwords in this game are longer than in any game we have dealt so far. 16 letters. And there is such a weird number of symbols to choose from too. 36. And the password scheme is quite resistant to tampering. In my experience, it is pretty much impossible to come up with a valid password by trying randomly. Now, before we go any bit forward, let me explain one important thing. The password screens in the NTSC and PAL versions of this game are different. But this is just a smoke screen. It's just a font change. In this side-by-side illustration, you can see that even though the passwords look different, the cursor picks characters from exactly same positions, and both passwords are accepted and work the same. For the rest of this video, we will focus on the NTSC version. To convert between NTSC and PAL passwords, follow this chart. Now let's make a summary of everything the game saves in the password. The whole plot of the game is that Simon, collects the body parts of Dracula in order to seal the curse that has been nefariously festering his health and causing the forests to be populated with demons. The body parts are 5. The rib, the heart, the eye, the nail, and the ring. The number of possible combinations thereof is 32. The items are 4. The silk bag, the rosary, the laurels, and the garlics. The weapons are dagger, silver knife, golden knife, holy water, diamond flame, and the venerable oak stake. There's the herbs. The crystal may be nil, white, blue, or red. The whip may be leather, thorn, chain, morning star, or fire. The password also records which day you are on. And finally, true to an RPG, there's a player level. The maximum level is 6. This brings the total amount of data to 36 bits, assuming all combinations of data are reasonable. Now let's see what the password is actually capable of. The password is 16 letters long, and each letter is one of these 36 symbols. This means that there can be 7 septillion, 958 sextillion, 661 quintillion, 109 quadrillion, 946 trillion, 400 billion, 884 million, 391,000, and 936 different passwords. But there's trickery here. The first 4 symbols and the last 4 symbols actually are exactly the same. The game may sometimes generate a password that contains numbers 6, 7, 9, and 8, but for reasons that will be evident later, you can actually enter them as A, B, C, or D instead. So the actual number of symbols is 32. 5 bits are stored in each letter, so this brings the total amount of password data to 80 bits, or 10 bytes. Now the very first part of the password decoding process is to convert the password data from 16 5-bit letters into 10 8-bit bytes. Each letter conveys 5 bits of data, but they are packed into 8-bit bytes in the manner shown in this chart. And here's the code from the actual game responsible for that conversion. For brevity, here's an example JavaScript function that does the conversion both ways. Now that we are down to bytes rather than letters, this is a map of the contents of each byte. The first byte contains the player level, the second byte contains the day number in binary coded decimal format as was the common practice in NES games. The third byte contains the number of laurels in the low nibble and the number of garlics in the high nibble. The fourth byte contains the body parts and the crystal type. The fifth byte contains item flags, the sixth byte contains weapon flags, the seventh byte contains the whip type. The game checks very meticulously that all the values are in valid ranges. It is not possible to craft passwords that cause the game to crash. Any unused fields must also be at 0, or the password will not be accepted. The next 2 bytes contain a 16-bit checksum. This checksum must match the sum of all 7 preceding bytes, or the password will be rejected. The final byte contains 2 4-bit values that control the encryption of the password. Let's study the final byte separately. The XOR index is used to select one of these 14 element tables. Believe it or not, these tables are actually hard-coded into the game. The code looks like this. So the encryption algorithm chooses one of these 14 element tables. You notice there is also an add const. It is a 4-bit number. Here is how the XOR table and the add constant are used together in order to encrypt the password. Only the 14 first letters of the password are encrypted, because the last two are needed to construct the byte that contains the information how to decrypt the rest. When encrypting, first each letter is XORed with a value from the table, and then the add const is added to each letter. When decrypting, the same is done in reverse. First, the add const is subtracted from each letter, and then each letter is XORed with a value from the table. Here is the assembler code that does the adding, subtracting, and also the choosing of the add and XOR constants. Now, of particular interest here is the exact manner in how the game actually chooses the add constant values. There is no actual reason why the XOR index and the add value should be dependent of each other, but the game always chooses them in union. Picking the add values this way is one way of ensuring that they will never be larger than 4. This means that the passwords may actually contain symbols from the redundant subsection, but it also means that for every possible situation in the game will generate one of the 16 different passwords, while it actually could generate 256 different passwords. All of the passwords shown on this screen are accepted by the game and produce exactly the same game state. Now I wrote some code that can actually decode and generate passwords of this game. It is written in C++. Unfortunately, the code is rather long, but I still wanted to fit it in one screenful. So if you are watching this on anything that is not HD, you may want to download the file instead. You can find the link in the video description. Simon's Quest is such an underrated game, and I'm so glad I was able to get this theme down myself, even if it took disassembling the ROM to get it. I am Bisqwit, catch you next time when we study another alphabetic password theme.